Hello and welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for being here for Digital Diwali. I'm Glenna Barlow here at the Columbia Museum of Art, and I'm with Bhavna Vasudeva. We're here at the Visions from India exhibition. So since this is all about Diwali and we're here to celebrate, Bhavna, would you tell us a little bit more about what Diwali is, what it means to you, and how you like to celebrate?
Thanks, Glenna. I was born in India, but grew up in South Carolina, so I have my own way of celebrating Diwali, but the traditional way is we have a diya that we light, and the reason we do that is to celebrate the triumph of light over darkness, of good over evil, and that's what Diwali is about. And in this age of COVID, I think more than ever, we need to get out and come into the light.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us, Bhavna. That was lovely, and we're delighted to have you here to celebrate with us. We're delighted to have all of you here celebrating with us, too. We've got DJ Rekha, who'll be spinning all night, so stay tuned. We've got a lot more coming up for you. Welcome back. So we're back here at the Columbia Museum of Art, and next up, we're gonna show you how to make a rangoli. And rangolis are these colorful or sometimes just white patterns that are made with different kinds of powders. They're especially made for festivals, and you will find them all over India. So take a look at this video with Jugnu. She's gonna show you how to make a rangoli with materials you might even have in your own house.
It is thought to bring good luck, prosperity, and to welcome guests. It represents the culture of India. If you see in rangoli, there's so many things like dots, lines, circles. It has so much meaning behind why they use all those things. So a dot represents seeds, which is meaning of like life, you know, and then the lines is like connecting to people, so it's like connecting to dots, like affections. Semicircle is how you are getting knowledge, how much you can absorb it. If you'll go in like my home state, Bihar, they draw floor art with the rice paste and with this three fingers. The three fingers denotes power. And then after making that pattern, they put vermilion. It's a symbol of married woman, you know? And that vermilion are generally red or orange color. So where you will see the knots, they put their red and orange dots. They're supposed to be positive vibes. Namaste. Today I'm going to show how you can make rangoli with your very simple materials, what I use generally, you can find in your pantry. These are some colorful rice, what I colored with turmeric. You can just take a few drops of water and some powder, turmeric powder, then mix it and you will get very nice yellow rice color. Or this colorful lentils, like I got this green beans, and you can get some red beans, or you can use beetroot juice to color rice to make it red. Okay, some flowers I got from my garden. Anything colorful, colorful flowers. And then I have some rangoli powder, which is you can get from Indian grocery stores, okay? It's very easy to get and it's so handy. You can, if you'll buy one box, you can make so many rangoli out of it, all right? Now, generally we do this rangoli thing with a free hand, and the first thing is I'm gonna show you how to hold the rangoli powder and to release this, okay? So this is how we do, is like take a pinch of this powder, okay? And then you have to move your thumb across your forefinger. So only two fingers I'm using to hold a pinch of rangoli. See how I'm moving my thumb across my forefinger? Just like this. So I'm going to show you a small dots. With a pinch, you can make like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's simple dot, or big dot. So see what I'm doing is like holding my rangoli powder, it's a pinch, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's like a matrix. 5, 3, 1, okay? Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to make a line out of this. Just connecting dot to dot, okay? And this line is telling us like connecting one to the people, you know? It means affection. So basically I made a star kind of thing. 1, 2, 3, 4, you know. Out of this, I'm going to show how you can make a beautiful lotus flower. You have to keep in mind that where your, what's the size of your petal gonna be. And this is gonna help you to draw a line. So this is 4 petals now. Out of these 4 lines, I'm going to make more four petals. So it's gonna be 8 petals lotus flower. It's called astudal. Rangoli is supposed to be colorful, okay? So you can fill the color to make the rangoli more colorful and beautiful, okay? What I'm going to do, I'm gonna here fill with this lines. So this way you can practice more how you can hold the rangoli and create a beautiful pattern. So generally lotus is, you see, in pink color. So I'm going to fill some pink color over yellow. It's like kind of shading. You can blend it with just tapping. So here you can blend the color to look more realistic. Flower petal, lotus petal. So I'm gonna show you how you can use all these flowers and some lentils and rice also, because back in India, women, they do almost every day in front of their yard. It's just not a part of like decoration. It's supposed to be more meaningful to others also. So let me see, let me show you. This is what you can put: flower in the center, some lentils around, and this lentils they put to feed the birds and ants. They use rice flour also to feed the birds and ants because they are part of our life. And the women, they are teaching to their kids from one generation to others that they are part of our life. All right, so here you go. You can use the rice also to fill this rangoli and it's gonna be look more colorful. Just like rangoli powder, how you hold in a pinch and then slowly release it. It's very easy to do. All right. So my one small rangoli is ready and you can do more in it and you can make it bigger size also and so on. But let me show you how you can use some stencils also, you know, and it's very easy. So if you want to start to make your own rangoli, you can use this stencil and you can do very easily way. The only thing is what you have to buy this rangoli stencils. You can get from any grocery store or Amazon, you know, any grocery store. So for that, what I did, I got this shaker, it's just like a salt and pepper shaker. And I filled the rangoli powder, you know, in it, and it has some small holes. Now what I'm gonna, what you have to do is just hold it, go over it, and move your shaker around your stencil, okay, with your finger. Just make sure it's going through all the hole. Ta-da! All right, I'm gonna show you how you can make a simple flower too, okay? Out of this bangle. So what you have to do, just place on the floor here. With this finger, just do this. It's like I'm making a circle. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I'm using more color, same way, very easy. Another color. Okay, here you go. I hope you like this video and please try this rangoli. It's so beautiful and happy Diwali.
Okay, welcome back. We're here at the CMA again. Hopefully you enjoyed that rangoli video. Maybe you tried a little bit out at home. Now we're gonna shift gears and look at some other kinds of patterns. So we're here tonight, of course, celebrating Diwali, but we're also celebrating Visions from India, which is the current exhibition here at the Columbia Museum of Art. So we are thrilled to have this show here. We love the variety of different works that we get to experience. And tonight, I thought I would showcase a couple that I've really enjoyed getting to know better just for you. So what's so rewarding about seeing this show in person, physically coming into the galleries, is that you'll get to see all of these gorgeous details. So many of these pieces have so much detail. They're meticulously elaborate, and no two pieces could better express that than this here. So these two are by Avinash Viraraghavan. And if we'll take a look at this first image on the right initially. Now, you probably recognize this screen, right? If I can call it that. So this may look familiar to you. Maybe you played this game back in your childhood. Maybe you played it last week down the street at Transmission Arcade. But this is Frogger. This is the classic 1981 arcade game. And you can see here, if we look really closely, that the artist has actually created one of these screens using embroidered beadwork. So each of those tiny little dots is a glass bead. And look at just the incredible detail that you get from that image. So it might seem kind of strange to take something as fleeting as a screen that you see on a video game and create something so elaborate that took so much time. But now let's consider it with this piece on the left, because they're really a pair that go together. You can see some similarities right away. So first, there's some beadwork that you're gonna see here. So if you get real close, you can see the kind of shimmery, shiny quality of these beads. And there's a lot of pattern to them. So there's different patterns that you'll see throughout the image. It's not just beadwork though. There's beadwork and a variety of different patterns throughout, but there's also some textile, some kind of woven pattern as well. So even though it's monochromatic, it's all kind of different shades of black and white, we can start to see something of an image here. And what might help is actually if you tilt your head to the left, can you make anything out here? Well, this is actually a still image that's taken from a film. It's actually Jean Cocteau's film, Orpheus. So if we look a little bit sideways, we can start to see this figure here is one face, and then this here is his reflection. He's got his arm kind of curved up around this way. And so you start to maybe see how this could represent an image. Again, just a fleeting image on a screen as part of a film, but captured here in these beautiful, meticulous details. Now, the question is, what do these two have to do with one another, right? Well, the title of this piece is Orpheus. And Orpheus is the name of the film that this still comes from, but Orpheus also goes back to Greek mythology, and it's really all about crossing over and going on a journey to try to get to the other side and facing all of these obstacles along the way. You could do that literally in a film about Orpheus, as we see here, but Frogger is really about the same thing, right? It's that little frog trying to get to the other side. So here, Avinash Viraraghavan is really kind of combining this, what we might call high art and low art, but bring it all into this form of embroidery. So I hope the next time you're here at the CMA, you'll come on and check it out and really get up close so you can see the beautiful details in this beadwork. Hey, welcome back. So next up, we've got a treat for you. We've got a dance coming up from Rani from UofSC Moksha. She's got some steps to show you so you can try out your own Bollywood dance. The song is called Aja Nachale, which means come dance. So get up and get ready.
Hi everyone, my name is Ronnie Thacker and I go to the University of South Carolina, and at UofSC I'm a part of a Bollywood fusion dance team called UofSC Moksha. UofSC Moksha is competitive, so we go around the nation and compete with other schools. And so today I'm going to be teaching you guys a Bollywood fusion dance called Ajay Mechale. That's what the song is called. It means come and dance. So let's get started with the dance. All right, so you're gonna start with your hands on your hips. You're gonna sway left, right. So you're gonna go left, right. From here, you're gonna be sitting on your right hip. Your left leg's gonna be out and your left leg will also be on your tippy toes. All right, so from here, you're gonna do a little hand movement. You're gonna have your hands turning, your wrist will be turning. So you're gonna do this with your left hand first, your right hand will be on your hip. You'll go one, two, three, and then the fourth one, you're gonna be doing a flower. From here, you're gonna go one, two, three, right above your head. Do the same thing with your right hand. One, two, three, four. One, two, three. All right, so from here, you're gonna put both your hands down, the same motion. One, two, three, four. From here, you're gonna be doing a little half wave on both hands. So you're gonna go one, two, three, four, and then together. All right, from here, you're gonna be taking both your hands and you're gonna be pushing out. Then you're gonna be doing the same thing again. You're gonna come back in, switch feet and switch hands. You're gonna go out, again, out. This is five, and this is the sixth time we'll be doing this. So you'll be ending like this. So these are the first few moves, and this is without the actual words yet, so this will just go to the music. So to demonstrate, I'm gonna do this with music. You're gonna have both your hands on your hips to start. And we're gonna start with just those words and we'll move on later. But how you're gonna start is you're gonna be, you ended here on your left leg sitting with your right foot up. You're going to shift to your right hip with your left leg standing and your left leg on a tippy toe. You're gonna have your hands in two okay signs. You're gonna put them by your ear and you're going to flick that. Okay? From here, you're gonna do one, two. Like, come here with me, okay? So you're gonna go flick. When you do that flick, your left hip moves up. You're gonna do one, two. You're going to point this way. Take your right hand, point this way. Your left hand, and we'll go forward and to the right. So, from here, you're gonna turn around. Your hand is gonna be at the top. You're gonna drop your right hand, look back. You're gonna drop your left hand, look back. And then you're gonna turn around. But your hands will be different when you're turning around. When you're turning around, your hands will be with your two palms. One will be facing up, one will be facing down, and you're just gonna alternate it about three times. So you're gonna go back here, right hand back, left hand back, alternate. All right, and while you're doing that, just bring your foot around. There's no concrete movement for that. So you're gonna start right here, you're gonna hit one, two, come with me. Hit one, two, three, around. Right hand back, left hand back, hit one, two, three. So those are the moves. And then we're gonna just keep moving on, we'll play the music in a little bit. The next set of words say, she did a little bit of hip and she got a little shy. So we're gonna follow with those words. You're gonna take your hands, you're gonna clasp them together. You start with your right on the right angle. From here, you're gonna take your hands and you're gonna hit it to your left hip. Then you do the same thing with your hands right here and you're gonna hit it to the right hip. And then you're gonna put your left foot back forward and take both your hands and you're gonna cover your face. While you're covering your face, feel free to do some hip, not required again, but it does add a little flair. So the moves from here go hit, one, two, three. All right, so let's play some music so you guys get a little hang of it. We're gonna start from the beginning again. So hands on hips. Thank you. She puts an anklet around her leg. She hears you coming, and she's there. That's what those words mean. So your left leg's out, take your anklet, you're gonna clasp it around, then you're gonna take your right hand, put it to your ear, take your left hand, take it out, and move this way. So take your anklet, put it around, you hear someone coming, you take your hands on your hips, and you pump, one, two, three. All right, so again, around, hear someone coming, one, two, three. From here, you're going to do something simple. You're gonna take your, you're gonna face your body forwards. You take your right hand, you're gonna go up. So just a little turn your hand and flower up. Your right hand's gonna come across your body, around, and you're gonna pose on your, you're going to put your weight on your right hip. So sit down again with your left foot on your tippy toe here. And you're gonna look up with a little bit of confidence. And when the words say aja, that's your cue to move on to the next step. So from here, you hear aja, and it's going to the next step. But before we go along, I'm gonna go back and do it again from the beginning. So, with the music, hands on hips.
Thank you.
much for learning with me. And from UofSC Moksha, very happy Diwali. Thank you.
All right, hopefully that got you up and moving. So now we've got for you a virtual bazaar of sorts. Since we can't be here together with a bazaar full of different vendors and artisans, we thought we'd bring the vendors to you. So coming up next, we've got Ruchita from People Tree, and she's going to show you all about block printing, her studio, her process, and then she'll even do a little demo to show you how you can try block printing at home. Check it out.
Hi everyone, this is Ruchita. I'm the owner, the designer of People Tree. I make block print textiles. Block printing is the art of printing with hand-carved wood blocks on paper or fabric. In the end, I'm going to show you a quick demo how to make your own block print cards. But first, we start with the blocks themselves. I have a stash here, which is different designs of, like, this one is a Wisconsin one that has been used a lot lately. There is a cat one. There is Monstera leaf, which is my husband's favorite plant, so I love this one. And right here, let me quickly introduce you to Ray, who's getting fidgety, who's my 2.5-year-old Wheaton, and she's my constant companion and encourager. And she settled herself, so we can continue. This is my wall of inspiration right here, things that inspire me. So my family, my kids are on this. And this is a print I'm working on right now for winter. So you can see there are some pine trees, and I'll be adding some snowflakes, adding that white, lovely, fluffy, wintry stuff. Moving on to this side, this is my shelf of things which are getting ready to go out in the world. So there are some napkins that are ready to get mailed out, some handmade cards. And this big box is heading to Wisconsin with the Wisconsin print towels. I'm going to move on to this side, which is my the area for cotton tunics, cover-ups, swim, beach cover-ups. These are all pure cotton. It's something like what I'm wearing right now. And they're hand-dyed, they're hand-printed, and they're just simply gorgeous. And they're all on my Etsy site. Do check them out. Here is my little shipping station where I ship my packages out. This side, I have my tea towels that have just been printed. They're drying right now. Some will head out in the world and some will not, because I've made some mistakes on them, or they're just not feeling them, that they're ready to get out there. Over here is my shelf of natural dyed fabrics that have just arrived. So they're fresh off the printing table. They are waiting for their turn in the sun to be turned into table napkins, some sort of table linen, like runners, like, and they are like this, which is the very berry print. These are all on my Etsy, so do check them out. They are wonderful. They are eco-friendly. They are reusable, washable. So do check these out. I want to show you this particular towel that has been very popular. I call him my naughty rooster. This is the Rise and Shine Mother Cluckers towels that's in a lot of stores, in the local shops. I absolutely love this guy. Moving back to the table, this is my well-used, well-loved printing table. I don't know if you can see, but there are some remnants of prints. Like, here is the butt of an elephant. There's a camel there. Some snowflakes there, but this table has seen a lot of history, a lot of use and work in the last 7 years. And these are the masks that are getting ready to get sewn, some towels that are getting ready to get printed. And here I have the card, and I'm going to show you how to print your own block print card. So let's go. Hi everyone, this is Ruchita again. I'm going to give you guys a quick demo how to make your own block print cards. And first, I'm going to show you what materials I use. So if you look down here, I'm starting off with this gorgeous handmade paper that is made from cotton rags. You can literally use any paper that doesn't have too much texture on it. I have an old plate in which you can put your paint. This is a brush, like a foam brush. You can get it at Michael's. In fact, most of these things you can get at Michael's. This is a block I'm going to be using. It's a maple leaf going in with the fall theme. And these are the colors I'm using for printer. It's a simple craft paint. You can use acrylic, you can also use fabric paint. And this is the medium that I'm using to just thin out the paint a little bit, which helps in printing better. So turn on your favorite music and let's get printing. So I have red paint here and I'm gonna put a little bit of the medium just to thin out the paint a little bit. Give it a quick mix. Just feel that it's ready to work and then slowly and evenly put it on your block. Mine is a nice maple leaf. And press it down, give it a firm press, lift it, and there you have a beautiful, gorgeous leaf. I'm gonna show you once more. And there you go, look at that. And you can mix and match colors. You can wash this block with water and then add on the purple color if you want. Literally, the world is your oyster. So go ahead, make your own cards, send it to somebody you love. So happy block printing.
Hey, welcome back. Well, after all this dancing, I'm sure you're working up a little bit of an appetite. So next up, we've got Jugnu. She's gonna show you how to make a very simple, no cooking snack that's gonna be really tasty. So check it out.
Namaste everyone, my name is Jugnu Verma and I'm gonna show you how to make a very classic, tangy, crispy and sweet little spicy snack, that is bhel puri, which is very common street food in India. And let me show you how to make it, okay? So here are just some ingredients for bhel puri. We need bhel puri mix, some kulcha, which is optional, boiled potatoes, fresh cilantro. This is optional thing, this is raw mango, some cucumber, onion, tomato. This is Thai green chili, it's really hot. What you can do, you can de-seed it and then chop it roughly. These are chutney, which is coriander green chutney. And this is Bombay bhel puri chutney. Let me show you how you can make it. So first thing we need is to chop some salad, basic salad, which is cucumber and tomato and onion. Just basic roughly chop, you know, bite size. You don't have to be like very small or very fine, if not. So this will go straight to the bowl. Now we need some tomato, and what you have to do, first you have to de-seed it because we need just the top of the tomato, not the seed one, because it's gonna make your bhel more soggy. So roughly chop tomato. Seeded this thing. Straight to the bowl. Now we need some onion. It's just regular onion. And again, you have to chop to bite size pieces. Okay, there you go, to the bowl. Now we need some chutney. Along with that, let me show you one more nice ingredient, that is raw mango. Always use raw mango, which is optional, because it's gonna give you tangy a little sweet taste, but try to use raw mango, and it's optional because I like raw mango in my bed. It's always reminding me my countryside thing. Boiled potato. Again, you have to just chop like a salad size. All right. I'm going to use half, not much. And again, veal puri is a gluten-free snack. So you can enjoy if you are looking for gluten things and you are not allowed or you don't want to eat gluten. It's a perfect snack for you. All right, so these are my spicy salads, which is ready. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you my masala dabba. This is what in my masala dabba, basic bus, what I use. This is turmeric, red chili powder, coriander powder, and some cumin, pachfuran, and I have some chaat masala, which is it's like a seasoning. And chaat masala is a mixture of, you can say powder, dry mango powder, black salt, cumin, and some other seeds, which is, you can use as a seasoning and taste amazing. You can feel this like a little spicy, but kind of tangy taste, but not hot. So you can use as your basic salad also. All right, now I'm gonna use that. What I'm gonna do that, I'm going to use my, I'm gonna mix my chutney. So these are some green chutney. And these are some ingredients what I got from Indian grocery, which is on Bush River Road. It's behind a Cracker Barrel, you know. So they have lots of ingredients. You can go and you can explore. They have so many things. Even sometimes when I go back to India, I live in North region in India. Sometimes I don't get some stuff which is in southern part of India, but here everything is available. It's amazing store. All right, so this is how you're gonna mix the salad with chutney, green chutney, and this is bhel puri chutney, which is called red chutney. It's made of generally tamarind, okay? Now, this stuff is ready. Now what I'm going to do, this is bhel puri mix. You don't have to buy separate things. Everything is there. And what you're gonna do, they had so many stuffs already but there, but I'm going to use just bhel puri mix. Right here. And then, if you go to India and buy street food from a street vendor, what they do, they serve in a paper cone, and it looks very authentic. Okay, so let me show you how you can serve this. So just mix a little, and then put in a cone. And top with some save bhujia. It's like a crispy and very, very mild salty snack. Okay. And top with some cilantro. Here you go. Now you can enjoy this bhel with your family and friends with masala chaat. All right. Thank you so much.
Hey, welcome back. So did you try your hand at bhel puri? If you did, be sure to share those posts with hashtag Digital Diwali and tag us at Kola Museum. Okay, next up for you, we've got another vendor spotlight. This one comes from Sonal, who's based in Charlotte, but she works with artisans who are in India. So this video will show you all about what their process is. You'll learn a little bit more about Kantha embroidery, and you can check out their Etsy shop at Shree Roopam, USA. Check it out. Thank you. Hey there. So as many of you know, Diwali or Deepavali is the festival of lights. So for many people who celebrate, that means lighting up lanterns, setting off fireworks, or lighting a diya, which is a traditional clay oil lamp. So next up, we've got Vani from Articulate, who's gonna show us how to make one of those clay diyas using air dry clay. So if you got your diya kit from the CMA, go ahead and grab that now. And don't forget to share your posts of your diyas and videos of you making them with hashtag Digital Diwali and tag us at Kola Museum.
Thank you. So welcome back. I'm Catherine Walworth, curator at the Columbia Museum of Art, and I'm here to look with you at a very different type of piece. It's by Sudarshan Shetty, who has two of the more sort of famous popular pieces in the show that are made out of wood and they feel very craft-based. But this one is completely different. It's so contemporary. I mean, it's using this clear plex plastic. It's a new media piece. You don't always expect new media when you think of India, perhaps, but you should, because this is global contemporary art. And it's this installation piece where all of these are dogs with cameras embedded in them that are watching you when you're here, and you can see what they're seeing. So if art is about the body, in this case, I am both looking at the bodies of these dog skeletons, but they're looking at my body and showing, it's as if you can see their mind's eye behind them. So I don't have a complete explanation for what this piece means. That's what's so great about it. There are all these clues that you can put together in your own way. I think in some ways this is a very urban piece. I think it talks about cities, but it's also just kind of a mystery. And it's for you to work out and also to experience physically. And one of the things I love about it, in terms of its materials being so contemporary, it's right across from this beautiful triptych by Bharti Kher, which uses bindis, which themselves are made out of plastic. And bindis are known as the third eye. So if you want to think of this piece being all about surveillance, to my back, if I were to turn, this triptych by Bharti Kher is also surveilling me. It's also watching me with all of these thousands of third eyes, essentially. So there's almost, I think of this corridor between these pieces as almost a vortex of being watched. But it's just about the way the gallery is set up and what the artists are bringing to their pieces. So it's really fun to watch yourself moving in this piece. It's really fun to walk around and just think about what the artist had in mind with this. It's also great just to be surprised. I love the surprise of this entire exhibition. Each gallery is very different, but this piece in particular, it shows the range that these artists are working at. Bharti Kher, for example, also makes sculptures in addition to her 2D pieces. So these artists are just so ambitious and their minds are so imaginative and wonderful. So there's nothing quite like this particular work in the exhibition. I hope you come and experience it yourselves. Walk around, think about what these dogs are thinking about you, and just enjoy the rest of the exhibition. Thanks so much.
Hey there, welcome back. So like all great holidays, Diwali has rich traditions all around food. So family and friends will often share sweets or mithai as a way to kind of spread joy. So next up, we've got Viji, who's going to show you how to make some simple but delicious Indian sweets. Enjoy.
This dish is called rasmalai. My quick version of it is made with ricotta cheese, but the traditional way is making it with cottage cheese. Actually, in India or the Indian language, it's called paneer. And it's a little bit lengthy. People who are quick at it can do it fast. But for me, this is a great substitute. And anybody can do it because you can find ricotta cheese in all the grocery stores. I use the whole milk ricotta cheese. So this is a 1 pound container of ricotta cheese. And to this, I'm going to add 3/4 cup sugar. And just mix it together, and it's baked for about at 350 for about half hour till it's light brown. You just mix it so the sugar is all mixed together, and you would just smooth it out. You know, it should be probably about a half inch thick. It's not, you don't want it too thin or too thick. And I'm going to put this in the oven now and wait for that to come out. Well, it's 30 minutes now, so I'm just going to pull out my dish from the oven. And this is how it looks. And I'm just going to cut it into squares. And then I'm going to put it into my serving dish. All I'm going to do is now, after this, pour half and half over it. This has got enough sugar that I don't need to sweeten the half and half. So that's even easier to do. So that's it. And I'm just going to, this is about a cup of half and half. I'm going to pour it over. The dish. Now I'm not going to turn that over because then it'll all spill. And garnish it with any nuts you want, like pistachios or almonds. I've just got some almonds and I'm just going to put some over it, but you could put a combination of nuts on it, and it's ready to go. Now I'm going to make a dish called Gajar Halwa, which is translates into carrot halwa or pudding. And I've grated 2 cups of carrots. And what I'm going to do is add, you could use butter also, but I'm going to use like a tablespoon of ghee, which is clarified butter. You can get this from all the grocery stores, have it now. Trader Joe's is my go-to place. And heat the oil in the wok or a frying pan, and I'm going to add my carrots to this and saute this for a till it gets soft for about 3-4 minutes. So it's about 3-4 minutes now. So I'm going to add about 1/2 cup of milk to this. And let that simmer. And to this, I'm going to add 2 tablespoons of milk powder just to thicken it. And just simmer this until it all cooks down and the milk is and the carrot is further cooked. And it's all absorbed. And the interesting thing about this quick recipe is the fact that I'm not going to add any sugar. I'm just going to add condensed milk. That will give you the sweetness. And the thing which is optional is cardamom powder. You can grind it yourself or you can buy the cardamom powder in the grocery store. It's just a little bit, maybe 1/4 teaspoon or 1/8 teaspoon. And the other ingredient I add, which is again optional, is saffron. These are saffron strands I have, which I'm just going to drop it in just to give it the flavor. Okay. And the saffron you can buy from any grocery store. The Indian grocery store probably has the cheapest price. You can buy a box like this, and I put it in the freezer so I don't want to lose its freshness because I don't necessarily, it's very expensive, so I don't really use it unless it's for a special occasion. Okay, now I'm going to add the condensed milk. It's about 1/4 cup of condensed milk. You can adjust the taste or add more as time goes on. And this is great served warm. And you know, I really enjoy when you serve it with a little bit of whipping cream. Not, I don't mean cool whip or the ready whip. It's just the pouring whipping cream. And it's done. I'm just going to pour it into my container and decorate it with some nuts. This recipe, I'm going to make this in the microwave. It's again like a milk fudge recipe. And you mix everything in a microwave for about a total of 3 minutes. And So you mix, this is about a quarter cup of, actually I have half the recipe, but this is about a quarter cup of butter. This is a cup of milk powder. And about a little over, just it's actually half a can of the condensed milk, which is a little bit, about a half cup, maybe two-thirds cup condensed milk. And you mix it all together. I'm going to put it in the microwave for about, for right now for 30 seconds. I'm just going to melt the butter and stir it. But it's a total of 3 minutes. But you need to do it at 30 seconds or a minute intervals. So now the butter is melted, so it's all mixing well. Okay, so I'm going to put it again for another minute. This is so much faster than cooking it on the stove because you really have to watch the milk burning at the bottom. Yeah, it's all bubbly. I think this is good. I just want it all come together so that it looks like a dough, like a cookie dough, if you want to call it. So I'm just going to stir it for a bit just to so that I can handle it with my hands, like wash my hands. You need to grease your palms a little bit with some oil or ghee. I could do it, otherwise it would stick to my hands. I'm going to take some grease, butter, ghee on my hands and take a small amount of this dough. And you can make the size of whatever you would like and just roll it into a smooth ball. Put it on your plate, and to make an imprint, the simplest I found, like the design of an empty spool, and I'm just going to press it. So it just gets a little of an imprint on top. Just take a small amount. Or as I said, people can put it into a little candy mold if you want to, but this you can control. Just roll it in your hands like a round ball, flatten it a little bit, and then press that. And this is called peda or milk fudge. And then I would decorate it with pistachio. I have some slivered almonds here, which I can just put on top. And it's all done.
Hey there, welcome back. Hopefully you got some snacks. Now we are nearing the end of our festivities, but it just would not be a complete night of celebration without a little bit of Bhangra. So we are going all the way to the Punjab by way of Columbia, South Carolina. Next up for you, we've got a performance by a contingent of USC's very own Gamecock Bhangra. So get up, get excited, and get ready to do some Bhangra. Chihuahua. Venya. Venya. Nats. Venya. Wabagagi. Chihuahua. 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 Venya. Chihuahua. Come on! Hey, welcome to the Happy Happy. Welcome back to the CMA. Sadly, we have come to the end of our festivities, but thank you so much for joining us. We hope you've enjoyed celebrating as much as we have. A huge thank you to DJ Rikka. Thank you so much to all of our collaborators, partners, and sponsors. We hope you've enjoyed this celebration. And now, as we close things out, we want to showcase how all of you celebrate Diwali. So get in on the fun, share your posts, your videos with us at hashtag Digital Diwali and tag us at Kola Museum. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We hope you enjoyed it, and happy Diwali from the CMA.
Happy Diwali, honey.
Happy Diwali to you.
Happy Diwali, all of you.